And these words are my bullets. I'll fight with these weapons against oppression to promote peace. We should care about Australia's interest, not America's interest. We are Australian.
The center of Australia's biggest city was shut down for nearly 16 hours after a gunman walked into a coffee shop, the Lindt Chocolate Cafe in Sydney, Australia, took hostages and for 16 hours demanded that they fly the ISIS flag. He wanted to speak with the Prime Minister of Australia, Tony Abbott, and had a whole host of other demands. Joining us now is Simon Kent. He's joining us from London, but of course, as we all know, is a native son of Australia. Tarek Fatah, of course, has stayed with us. Simon, let me go straight to you. You know, when it hits the heart of your homeland, like it did here with us in Canada just a few short weeks ago, I know, of course, you're a political commentator and a newspaper editor, but it really drives home, does it not?
It does, and it's awful about sitting here in London this morning watching the same news feed as people were watching all around the world. I had the same creeping feeling up my spine, the same sense of ill ease I felt when I watched events happening in Ottawa just a few months ago, here again in London. You see these most appalling acts committed on a public stage, and the people committing them were looking for the oxygen of publicity, and they got it. Now, Sydney is my hometown. I knew exactly where this was happening. I know that part of the city very well. It is right at the very beating heart of Australia's biggest city. You're a short walk to the State Parliament building. You're the short walk to the headquarters of two of Australia's biggest banks. It's a 10-minute stroll to Sydney Harbour, to the Sydney Opera House. And all this dramatic scenery laid the backdrop for what this scumbag did today to capture the world's attention, to push whatever his tendentious agenda was. And let me also say, the Sydney media played their part. Apparently, during the whole hostage situation, he was putting out messages, he was getting hostages to phone media organisations, he was trying to go live to air, but the media said no, they weren't going to do that, and their response was very good. They said, we're not hostage negotiators, you're not coming on my radio show, you're not coming to a live cross to a TV show. They let the police professionals handle it. Sadly, in the end, one hostage died, but the shooter, the man who started all this this appalling chain of events, is dead, and I'd say good riddance.
Okay, Tarek, I want to talk a little bit about who this absolute thug was. Sheikh Man Haron Monis, we've got a lot of detail on him, because not only was he well known to authorities, he has quite a long rap sheet. Radical Muslim cleric, fled to Australia from Iran in 96, conducted a campaign posting hate-filled letters to the families of dead Australian soldiers. He was allegedly one of the organizers of the murder of his ex-wife, Nolene Paul. Not only just a murder, but her body was lit on fire. Charged with sexually assaulting 7 women, as claiming he was a spiritual advisor, and now charged with an extra 40 sexual offenses in October 2014. This SOB was out on bail. This, and now he's perpetrated this.
To begin with, he was a fraudulent refugee claimant. He's a Shia cleric, Shia extremist, who later on converted to Sunni Islam because he found more fertile soil, a larger audience. Mm-hmm. Okay? So there are a number of indicators that tell us what's going on and who does what in the Muslim community. His demand that the proper ISIS flag be brought on and waved over there was also a distraction, because even the flag that he already had was the Jamaat Nusra flag, which is the same flag as the Taliban, the Boko Haram, everyone else, but it led almost the Australian and British media, even CNN, debate for all 7 hours as to what the flag was. But such a person, you have to understand, why would he be out, which is a great question, if he's involved in the murder of his wife?
Well, exactly. I mean, we just showed an image there of him claiming he's a peaceful protester, but then he subsequently chained himself on the steps of the courthouse in Sydney. And Simon, I want to get a sense from you. Look, you had the two bombings in London a few short years ago. those emotions are still very raw for many people of London, like us here in Canada. Those individuals are watching this, and all of those emotions, you know, are brought back. And then, of course, we think to ourselves, okay, are there going to be copycats? Has there been increased security? Do you have any sense of any change on the streets of London?
I think London here, the last 12 months has been very much on edge, but I think the MI5 and MI6 are very proactive. Just earlier on today, there were 5 arrests made just outside of London, but people suspected of preparing or being part of a terror bombing campaign. I think people are very alert here, and it does seem to be a worldwide trend, and you can't legislate against stupidity. There are stupid people in the world who will make bad decisions, but when they have outcomes like this that we saw in Sydney today. I mean, you're raising very valid questions about the Australian judicial system. How is this man out on bail when he's charged with very serious offences? Well, that's something perhaps the presiding judge who heard the case could probably be best equipped to answer. At the moment, the world is facing these asymmetric threats from individuals who act on their own, and we've seen it in Ottawa, we saw it in Sydney. We've seen it on the streets of London last year, and this threat is ever present, and I think Tarek Fattah would be much better in a much better position than I am to perhaps pitch the story forward and say, where does the West go now, and why does the West should not turn away from its liberal, democratic and fundamental base of freedom to turn around and become a police state to stop this? I don't think that's the answer.